welcome. I'm Holly George, joined by Jedediah Rogers, and today we're speaking with Christine Cooper-Rompato, a professor of English literature at Utah State University, and the author of an article in our summer 2015 issue about women inventors in Utah Territory. Christine, thank you, and we're glad to have you here.
Well, thanks for inviting me. I'm thrilled to be here.
Good. Your article, published in the Utah Historical Quarterly, provides biographical sketches. Whew, I'm stumbling this morning. about five 19th yep. century women in Utah Territory who filed patents for their own invention. I want to know how you came to this subject. You are a medievalist and the co-editor of a journal on medieval literature.
Yes.
How did you get to studying women patenters in Utah Territory?
Well, that's kind of a hard question, and I'm trying to remember. And I came up with about three different stories for how I got to this point. And one of them is that my brother is actually a patent attorney, and so I've been really interested in patents. And I actually had a kind of idea that I wanted to patent myself probably about 10 years ago that I didn't do. And I started thinking about the patent as an invention and as a document and as a kind of cultural marker, something that describes a particular period at a particular time. And so
that's
the patent, or the idea that I had now, would be it's way passé, but at the time I thought it was, you know, right on the dot and it would have been good for that 1 minute. So that's one story. I also have been interested in technology and mathematics as a medievalist. I'm working on a book on numeracy, which is like literacy, but with numbers. So what kinds of mathematical abilities did people have? And working at Utah State, which is a, you know, a very tech-heavy university, I started thinking about what technical writing meant in the Middle Ages, and then also what technical writing means in the more modern period. And then also, on a personal note, I like reading old newspapers, so I like using the Utah digital newspaper library or the New York Times, and I actually was working on an article about an African American man who was self-taught, who was a mathematician, and he worked on pi in the 19th century. And then somehow from that I got into thinking about 19th century patents, and then it coincided with Utah, with the Women's History Month. And I thought, I'll just do a poster about Utah women's history. Oh, I wonder what women have done patents in Utah. And then before you know it, I just started to uncover all sorts of stuff. So I don't know which one of those came first.
That's a wonderful explanation. I really like the idea that as a cultural object from that certain time, and a snapshot that gives
as
you
a snapshot
idea.
From that particular time that tells you something about the wishes and desires and in that moment of that particular person or that particular culture.
That's really interesting. Okay.
So did you say that you actually had a patent yourself?
No, I was thinking about it. I would really love to apply for a patent. And
what, may I ask, what would that have been?
Well, I don't know. According to my brother, I'm not supposed to share any ideas.
That's right. The world is confidential.
It is confident. It just seemed really kind of complicated. Who I would have had to consult to do it at that time. It would have been really expensive, and I didn't do it. And then, like I said, it's passé, so it probably wouldn't matter now. But you never know; it might come back.
Well, that's fascinating. Maybe that kind of transitions to sort of this. One of the strengths of your article, I think, is that you provide this general context for patenting and inventing in the 19th century, and you indicate that, you know, by the late 19th century, there was this heightened interest and activity among women to file patents.
Certainly.
Why was that? What changed?
Well, I think there are quite a lot of ideas about why women were suddenly patenting, and then why women were getting more interest in the newspapers and in kind of popular culture about it. There's a great author, a scholar, an economist named B. Zarina Khan, who's talked about the economic history of the 19th century and what changed for women in terms of kind of their legal rights to own patents and to own the profits of those patents. And so she's traced women's patenting and the rise of women's patenting to those particular property and legal rights. And that women, this is the patents were the one area where women could basically be equal with men. They could own the patent and they could market that patent and then they could receive the profits for that patent too, right? It doesn't matter if you're a woman or a man when you have that patent in your hand. It doesn't mean that women weren't publishing patents under men's names, because we know probably they were, or that they were using initials and didn't want to come forward as a woman. There was, I think some prejudice against women in reading their patents, probably thinking that their patents were somehow derivative or trivial, that maybe if, you thought if you published it, like a book or a novel, if you published it with a man's name, people might think of it more highly. We might even think of J.K. Rowling, who published Harry Potter under the name J.K., because there was some fear that boys wouldn't want to read the Harry Potter series if they thought it was written by a woman. So whether it was the economic history or the legal history, or also I think women are just really pushing all the boundaries in the late 19th century, right? They're showing that they can do all of these different things. They are not confined to a domestic sphere the way we think that they might be. Women are out and they're farming, they're homesteading, they are, working alongside their families, their fathers and brothers and husbands. And they are basically showing that they're technologically savvy and proving something to themselves, to their families, and also really showing that they want to contribute economically to their families. I think one of the reasons of the push for patenting at this time is because women think that they can contribute financially, right? They're not, it's expensive to file a patent. It's at least $30, in the late 19th century. That's a lot of money. Mm-hmm. So for them to file a patent shows that I think I'm going to get some kind of financial gain from this. And I'm going to then use that financial gain either for my own security or for my family's security. And there are lots of advertisements in the papers for patent attorneys and making it much, much more easier, I think, for women to kind of gain access to the path for getting that patent, right? And women can serve as witnesses on patents. One of the women who I studied, Julia Sampson, she has two patents, but she then also was the witness on another patent too. So there's also some idea, I believe, that there's kind of communities of people who are working together. I've been studying a group of women in New Mexico, and they all are living in a very close-knit community, a very close community, and four of these women patent. And one of them serves as a witness on another patent for one of the other women. So there's definitely an idea that they're in communities that are encouraging each other to do this as well. These aren't isolated events necessarily. So I like to think of kind of a technological community, right? Like the way we think of textual communities in literature, that we have technological communities too that are encouraging, women are encouraging each other and families are encouraging women to do this.
That actually is interesting. I think we'll unpack some of those ideas that sort of you've mentioned. But in Utah, you only found, example, five women who filed patents.
Yep.
Was that the totality of?
No. So I looked at the first women in Utah territory. So there are certainly more women after that who are filing patents.
Oh, so up to 1896, five women.
So we had five women. And again, as I mentioned, there might have been more women, but we don't know their names necessarily, right? Because they might have filed under the names of men or using initials, right? But we have five verifiable women who were historical figures who filed. But there would have been more afterwards. And plus, one of the co-patentees of Matilda Busby, he filed, I think it was two patents, but then he assigned them to a woman.
Yeah.
And so we actually don't know what that means. When you assign a patent to someone, do you assign it to them because it was their idea? And so you, or their kind of co-idea, or did they give you financial backing for it? Or why would you assign that patent to someone after you filed for it? There's all sorts of reasons. So, it could be that that particular person who was, I believe, working in a post office, that she was somehow involved in the creation of that patent as well.
Could you give us a little brief background on each one of these women and their patents?
Of course. So Carrie Aurelia Monroe was a woman originally from, born in Massachusetts and then moved throughout the country and to San Francisco and then back to the Midwest. She was a patenter who worked on vapor baths. And vapor baths are a really fascinating invention. Mm-hmm. I'm really, you know, kind of amazed by vapor baths. So imagine a sauna that's in a box, right, that was used for health purposes. So this is a great 19th century idea that bathing, you know, keeps all of your kind of bodily fluids in order mm-hmm. and keeps your skin healthy as well as your outside, as well as your inside. And so she created the three different kinds of baths, which you would sit inside where your head was kind of sticking out of the box. And inside the box would be some kind of fire heat source, which would make water vapor. And in that water vapor would be something else that would have another kind of vapor, like sulfur or alcohol, for example. And your pores would open and you would breathe that vapor in and it would then cleanse or purify you. Right, and so this was an invention that was good for, they advertised good for miners who were suffering from arsenic mm-hmm. poisoning or good for leprosy, etc. She was married to a doctor who, and they had a vapor bath business where they sold vapor baths. And then they also had bathing springs up at Warm Springs. And they also had a bathing establishment on Salt Lake, too.
I think I told you my family was sick while I was working on this article. And I kept thinking of this image
of the man.
Of this man because, you know, vaporizer set up in my son's room everywhere.
Yeah, it's a really great thing. It was supposed to cure everything from scrofula to you name it. And it was even advertised for, this would be a really great invention for you to buy for your family. All the mothers needed it for their children.
Yes.
And you could just stick your children in it whenever they're sick and it would make them much better. And it's just a fantastic invention. I love her. So she has three different patents. The last patent she actually had, I believe she was at that point in Ohio or Iowa when she patented the last one.
And she wanted it to be made out of paper mache.
Yeah.
How does that work? Maybe there's something I don't know.
Well, the last one was really amazing because it was collapsible. So part of your thinking, you know, you don't want this big, if you want to advertise this to be in your home, you don't want a big, huge monstrosity in the middle of your room. So what you want is something that's collapsible that will fold away. And so her last innovation was great, but she made this kind of telescoping vapor bath that would smush down, that you could put it away in your closet and then pull it out when you needed it and then elongate it too. So I don't know how the paper mache would stand up. She said paper mache or other.
Yeah.
Other material. But she's also thinking, you know, aesthetically about the home, what should be in the home and, you know, what, you know, how is it most convenient to be used too, which is pretty neat. Rebecca Henshaw is also really interesting to me. She was an Episcopalian who was from Ohio and seems quite well off. Her husband ran a mill and he died in a horrible explosion. Mm-hmm. And so she moved out to Utah along with some of her children who got married. And she invents a clothes hook. And this modest clothes hook, I was thinking about the clothes hook as I was driving down here today and like what's interesting about a clothes hook. And then really thinking about, you know, how this transforms your space in a home. Because really this is the time we're moving from clothes being in trunks, right? Mm-hmm. We're moving to putting them away. This is the time where we start to have closets too. And, mm-hmm. and you know, this idea of having a clothes hook probably saves some kind of labor that you have too. Do you need to iron things when you hang them on a clothes hook? Maybe not. And a clothes hook really being about both practical, you know, the practical idea of taking care of your property, but also display too. Thinking about when you go someplace and you hang your clothes. If I go and I hang my coat on a clothes hook in a restaurant, I'm displaying my coat, right, to other people. And then I'm also expecting that no one's going to take that coat, right? So if you look at the history of that clothes hook and all the other patents, it's really kind of neat because you see all different devices that people were doing and all the different problems that they were trying to fix. And so one of the problems that you see all the time is that people were actually stealing things from clothes hooks because they have people who are trying to create devices to stop thieves, So you have a clothes hook, but it has some kind of ingenious little part to it so that the thief can't get the clothes off of the clothes hook. And I thought, well, that's really interesting, because one of the first things that we learn when we're kids is to hang our things up on the hook, right? You come home and your mom says, hang your bag up. Or you walk into any school and there's clothes hooks down the hall. And you know that you're not supposed to take anything off those clothes hooks. So really with that clothes hook comes a whole set of assumptions, cultural assumptions and practices and norms that we learn too. And so really that's the kind of history that's behind the object that I'm interested in. I'm interested in the woman, but I'm really interested in the object too, right? Why they would have made that object at that time, but what is that object then? What kinds of ideas or forces are imbued in that object now? Yeah. And she's pretty neat. Matilda Busby is also fascinating. There's way more work to be done on her.
I like Matilda Busby. I like her.
Matilda Busby was really remarkable. She served as treasurer for several mining companies. She was in and out of the courts with all sorts of requests for land purchase. She obviously had a lot of unspendable income. She is sued on various occasions. She sues other people as well. And she is co-patentee for a wagon brake. And again, this really breaks down that domestic public sphere because she is a woman, obviously, but she is treasurer for a mining company. And so she is working on inventions having to do with mining. And wagon brakes really, you know, if you look at the history of wagon brakes and the patents, the problems that they're trying to solve often are this, you know, the wagon brake, if it breaks or if it doesn't break, right? Or if it lets go and then you have a horse carrying a very heavy load or a mule carrying a very heavy load, how do you keep that brake stable? How do you keep the animal safe and how do you keep people safe? So again, the history of that brake I think is interesting, but shows that women were also involved in that. And in Idaho, there was a patent done by a woman who it was for the step up into the wagon, right? You know, this idea that how do you step up into the wagon if you have long skirts on, for example. And this woman invented a step that could fold out and had multiple steps on it too. So you see women looking at, you know, the technology around them and thinking, how can I improve that for myself or how can I improve that for my business? Julia Sampson is also, she's remarkable. So she was British or English, and she immigrated to Utah. Her mother converted to Mormonism, and so she immigrated to Utah in the 1850s. And she was a professional seamstress, and she had two inventions. One was a portable binder for sheet music, right, as a musician. And the other was a fastener for clothing that you could fasten on flowers or other kinds of things so that you wouldn't have to sew things on to your clothing. You know, if you're performing, you could just fasten them on with like a little hook. And she's remarkable because we have a couple newspaper accounts of hers that she was working as a costumer for a tremendous performance that was celebrating George Washington, right, in the Tabernacle in Salt Lake, I believe. And there are thousands of people in attendance for this, and she's lauded for her costuming. And we could imagine that she might actually be using a fastener at some point. And she also sent on a picture, at least, of the sheet music binder to the World's Fair in 1893. And we know that women were inventing things, patenting them, and then either sending the actual objects or trying to send photographs of those objects to the World's Fair, to the Columbian Exhibition in 1893, which was a year late. You know, it should have been 1892, but they had it in 1893. So we know that she was, each state had a display, so I like to imagine that she might have been there as part of the Utah display. And the final woman is Jeanette Brown, who I love her patent too. So she's a remarkable woman too. Again, born in the East Coast, born in New York, married, we believe, to a mining engineer, and came out to Utah for a while, then moved on to Alaska and kind of moved to different states as well. But she does a remarkable thing, which is a life preserver for the head. And so basically, at this time, many people were trying to invent new kinds of life preservers that look, some of them are very wacky. But this one she does, and it has basically like little water wings that go around your head, and it's for keeping your head out of water, but then also for keeping the sun and the salt water out of your eyes, or the water out of your eyes. And I was really interested in thinking about her in the proximity of the Great Lake and all the wonderful bathing that was happening, you know, in the 1890s. Again, this is part of the health movement, right, that you go, you are in the sun, and you bathe, and this water helps you. And then at first I thought, well, why would you need a life preserver? river for your head, because the Salt Lake is so saline, you know, wouldn't you float? But then in looking into it, I realized that the Salt Lake actually didn't have as much salinity then as it does now. And that's because once they built the causeway, right, that goes across the Salt Lake, that actually changed the nature of the Salt Lake, and now it has more salinity. But it was actually not as saline in the 1890s, and so you actually, you know, you might float better, but it would still be something great to have your head out of the water and not get that salt water in your eyes, too. So that's remarkable. And again, I think of that one, I'm breaking down that domestic public sphere, because bathing is a very public recreational activity and a very kind of health activity, the used by men and women as well.
You mentioned the Great Salt Lake. Is there any evidence that direct evidence that she was actually thinking about the Great Salt Lake?
Not at all. And you know, being from the East Coast, she could be thinking about East Coast bathing, but I don't know. I mean, I'm from New England and I don't want to bathe in that cold water. Unless she was in Alaska after that.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, this is the 19th century, it's sort of in some ways predates sort of mass consumer culture to a certain extent. It's also inching in that direction. But I'm wondering, to what extent these inventions were actually local objects, did they reflect their culture and the geography of Utah?
That is a great question. Because when you think about a wagon break can be used anywhere. It might have been created in the culture of mining, which we would imagine would be Southwest, maybe New Mexico. You could have wagon breaks, you know, you could have wagon breaks in Colorado. But obviously that wagon break could then be used, you know, throughout the U.S. or, you know, throughout the world. Something like a portable binder for sheet music as well. Maybe that comes out of a particular milieu and a particular culture. You know, I'm thinking about, you know, the church here in Utah is really supporting music and musical performance as well, being a very important part of the 19th century, but also being able to be used in other places too. Vapor baths, of course, you know, used throughout the United States. But again, thinking about taking advantage of those particular hot springs that were here. I mean, this is a Utah feature. It's an Idaho feature as well. But having a bath that, you know, outside of Salt Lake City, very close to it where someone can go and bathe is, you know, that would be, imagine something that works very well here in Utah. So I think of these as being very, they are maybe created out of Utah and out of the topographical or geographical or cultural climate, but they are also marketable elsewhere. The same thing for a close hook. I mean, a close hook you can use just about anywhere, right? Whether or not they were ever marketed is a really tough question. Because although we have these patents which describe the object, it doesn't say anything about whether or not they were produced. And that's really where we often fall down and don't know anything unless...
I wanted to ask you, is anything produced?
We don't know. And that is, I could imagine the vapor baths, probably, the improvement in the vapor baths. So if Carrie Monroe has a store with her husband where they're selling vapor baths, her husband also has a patent too for breathing apparatus with the vapor baths. We could imagine that probably those patents were somehow put into use. And she's actually advertised in the paper when he goes away to San Francisco to start a business there that she is on hand and she will answer any questions. And she's the famous patentee who has patented this vapor bath. So I could imagine someone who has a store themselves who would then produce that object themselves and then sell it. Something like this clothes hook, you know, I can't tell. I don't know if it would have been produced or not produced. And it looks like a very good clothes hook to me.
so what benefit then would come to the woman?
Yeah. Yeah, imagined to do, so she could have sold that patent to someone.
Oh.
Right, afterwards. She could have sold it to someone else who wants to produce it. In fact, way back in the beginning when I first got interested in patenting, I was interested in the revolving table. So the revolving table is like the lazy Susan in the middle of the table.
The lazy Susan.
Yeah, and so this was an invention that was created and really got off the floor because of railroads. So what happens, you have a train coming into a depot, hundreds of people get off that train, they have half an hour to eat, and then they're going to leave again. So the revolving table got bought by railroad depots as a way to feed lots of people very quickly. In fact, there was a place here in Ogden that did that, right? So I was tracing who created the Lazy Susan? And I came back, there was a woman in the Midwest who it was attributed to. But then I found that there was a place in Logan, actually, a music store that was selling a revolving table. And then when I got back to that, I got back through that revolving table and found out that there was someone else from another state who was producing that table for Logan, and that they were selling it throughout the state. And they sold it for just a few years, and then I think they saturated the market. Mm-hmm. And then I tried to trace that back and realize, okay, how did we get from Logan to this revolving table that was created? And I could never get back that far. So obviously someone must have sold a patent to someone or sold the rights to someone who then had someone else manufacture it, who then had someone else produce it. And so I think that's what's going to happen with these. Probably is that I would have to be able to, trace a path of manufacturing. And I haven't been able to do that. So with the Closic, I have no idea. The vehicle brake, too, I have no idea about that vehicle brake, how it was sold. Mm-hmm. And probably if I knew more about brakes themselves, you know, maybe I could go through and look at, you know, maybe modern brakes or look at brakes on wagons and go back and see. But the same thing for that life preserver on the head, I have absolutely no idea. So that's something I would love to know.
You know what, one thing that's fascinating to me as you talk is how your study of this 19th century technology was facilitated by 21st century technology.
Yes.
And that's something I really noticed in your notes is, okay, so you used a lot of Google patents online, which is a
yep.
really interesting resource. And then you and another article in this issue, another couple, really used a lot of the tools of online genealogical research.
Yes.
And so it's just so interesting. You think of the cultural and technological
yep.
moment and how this one
I couldn't have done
study
this.
Of that one. No.
I couldn't have done this 20 years ago. And part of that was personal. Actually, I sat down. I have a daughter who has significant special needs.
Uh-huh.
And so when she was younger, I pretty much needed to care for her most of the time.
Yeah.
So I didn't have the kind of opportunity to go ahead and do long trips or, you know, kind of research trips. So I actually sat down and thought, you know, I want to see what I can find from my living room. I want to see how much can I do on a project and what can I uncover just from where I am sitting here as I look after my daughter. And so it became a kind of project. So it was really neat to be able to see, okay, now we have Google patents. There's also, you know, the United States Patent Office has they have all their patents online too, but they're a little harder to search.
Mm-hmm.
So what Google patents enables you to do is to search by name and search by all, you know, kind of different kinds of keywords. And then you can go to the U.S. Patent Office and then search that way as well once you have the number. And then certainly genealogical databases, newspaper databases are fantastic,
mm-hmm.
right? Couldn't do this without newspaper databases as well. You know, if I had to go and look up the microfilm
mm-hmm.
and look up the index. And honestly, the other thing too, that the most helpful resource has to be librarians. Who, you know, I could go visit my Utah State Special Collection Librarian or the Government Documents Librarian
mm-hmm.
and go visit them and say, hey, I'm doing this. What kinds of resources are there out there for me? Oh, well, you need to look at this kind of index, the Polk Directory. You need to have this directory.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, other scholars in the field, my colleagues too, my 19th century, you know, literary historian friend, Carrie Holt, who can look at this and say, oh, I think you need to be reading this and this and this. So I was just really interested in knowing what can I do from my living room and from my library, what can I figure out as a kind of challenge? And I think that's the wonderful challenge of research, too, that anyone listening to this podcast can sit down and say, I think I want to find out about this particular object around me or this particular thing. It's all open to you on the internet.
So other than determining whether these patents had actually been commercially successful
mm-hmm.
or actually had, you know, constructed in any way.
Yeah.
Were there any other questions that really remain not answered?
Yeah. Mind? So, you know, really, once you start to look into women's lives and people's lives, and you really start to have all sorts of questions about what they did with their time and did they have other inventions and, you know, did they reap any kind of benefit from this at all? And so all I, you know, again, I'm limited because I'm just looking to see what's happened. Where can I trace them in the documents? You know, it's really frustrating, like the 1890 census we don't have. And so that's a big hole, you know, that I'd love to have some kind of magical reconstruction of it. And some states, like Idaho, have done a really good job, right, reconstructing their 1890 census. But I guess I have questions about the women who came after as well. So I have more questions about these women's lives. I have questions about the women who came after. I have questions about women in other states as well. You know, I've been working on a New Mexico project about these early women patentees or patenters. Two of them lived in towns that are now ghost towns, right? So, and it's really hard to kind of track what's happened to them after they leave these towns as well. So, you know, more information about them would be fantastic. It'd be really, really wonderful. So, you know, any relatives out there who know, recognize, oh, that's my great-great-grandmother. I would love to know more about them. And I guess thinking about, too, you know, just more about the history of these objects and about other objects in general. The really neat thing, as I said, is looking at just these particular objects that these women patented is thinking about, well, what about other objects that we have around us, right? Where did that object come from? And how did someone create that paper cup? Mm-hmm. And how did someone create that hand sanitizer?
And everything that goes into it.
Yeah, and everything that goes into it. Yeah, and the assumptions that go into it.
Links, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Really, and what did that facilitate? And did that original person, you know, did they make any money on that or not? Or probably not. Did they sell their patent to someone else? So, yeah, I have lots of questions.
Well, so you, I agree that your research article is based on some excellent research, really diving in depth into sources that sometimes a lot of historians just don't use. I'm also wondering to what extent the insights and tools that you've acquired over the years as a medievalist has sort of impacted the way that you approach this subject. Do you think that you had any insights as a kind of a non-Utah history scholar coming to a Utah history project like this?
That's a great question. There's like two great questions in there. So I think as a medievalist, my training was in medieval studies and not necessarily only in English. So my training was in history, English, and art history and Latin. So I think the neat thing about the patents are that actually brings together all of them. We have art history, we have the history of design, we have history, we have literature as well. And I think what medievalists and literary scholars in general, when we talk about literature or text, we talk about something not a work of poetry or fiction. When we think about texts, we think about all different kinds of texts. And it might be a recipe book, that's a fantastic text to look at. Or, an astronomical guide, you know, maybe it's Chaucer's treatise on the astrolabe. Well, it's not necessarily literary, but it is really interesting as what it says about medieval science, for example. So I think that, you know, my training in medieval studies kind of opened up this idea of what is a text, right? And what does that text say about a particular culture? And then really my time at Utah State working in a department that is, there's folklorists in my English department, there are linguists, there are technical writers, there are American studies specialists, there's English education. And so working alongside those colleagues really kind of opens up this field where you're like, oh, technical writing is actually really fascinating. And what kinds of things can you do with technical writing too? So I think part of it is being in a particular environment here at Utah State, which I don't think I would have necessarily had at another university. You know, Utah State's pretty unique in that sense that they brought together. I mean, there's not a lot of English departments that have folklore, for example, as part of them. And so all of that coming together at a university saying, yeah, this is a really worthy thing to be studying, and what else can you do with it? I belong to a writers group where we have people in that writers group from all different fields who come, and that's a really neat audience to bounce things off of. So I would think that, I hadn't been in Utah, I don't know if I would have studied this. And I think also coming from the outside, and I grew up in Massachusetts and Connecticut and Pennsylvania, Western history is really fascinating, and it's not something that I learned a lot about. Because, you know, you grew up in Pennsylvania, grew up outside of Gettysburg. You learn a lot about the Civil War, and you learn about Gettysburg. And, you know, Massachusetts, you learn about the Revolutionary War. So coming here, there was just a whole new world that opened up to me. And I love the idea that I can study history now that's not 600 years ago.
Oh.
For the Middle Ages, right? Hmm. I love that, where, you know, I can go visit medieval places and I can fly to England and do that. It's expensive. And look at manuscripts. But what a fantastic thing that I can be here in Utah and I can be driving to Salt Lake and I can see Warm Springs Road. And I know, here's the history behind Warm Springs Road. That's fantastic. Hmm. You know, that's something I can share with my children. I can share it with my students. And it's just, I think it's wonderful.
I agree.
Did I answer both of those questions?
Absolutely.
Yeah. I'm just thinking how nice it is to know local history.
Yeah.
And become grounded where you're at.
It is, yeah. It's really the grounding. I was just thinking of an interesting Devil's Slide, because I drive my daughter to hippotherapy, which is horse therapy, in Park City every week. And so we drive by Devil's Slide, and then I just started reading about the history of Devil's Slide, and they used to have initiation rites for one of the, it was either Shriners or the Masons, I can't remember which. Anyway, they would ride down Devil's Shrine in like 1906. And there was a town there that's now a ghost town, and so you just drive by that and think, oh, how interesting.
Hmm.
Did I say Devil's Slide or Devil's... Yeah, Devil's Slide. Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
So now I'm thinking, I'm trying to think of these. It's almost like you took an interdisciplinary approach to this particular subject. Is there... What specifically is the element of folklore and in the stories that you tell about these women and their adventures?
That's interesting.
Is there a marriage between those?
That's such an interesting question, too. So I think, when you think about folklore is the study of kind of cultural understandings and cultural texts that are produced, I think, in a popular setting is how I would describe it. So, you know, in contrast to maybe, you know, reading a Chaucerian manuscript, which reached a certain number of people and, you know, a particular manuscript that was owned by, you know, a wealthy person. Folklore is something that, is experienced by, I think, in, you know, hundreds of maybe thousands of people, right? Or you could have folklore of a small community that would be more localized. So when I think about folklore, I guess it would be, I don't know if I'm going to answer this very well, but I'm coming back to that clothes hook again. Mm-hmm. And thinking about the way in which that clothes hook has shaped so many people's kind of everyday lives. Right? And stories that a person might tell about a particular thing that was hanging on a hook, right? Or I'm thinking about the shakers I've always been really interested in, right? And how they would hang their, when they cleaned, right? They would hang all of their furniture up on the wall so they could clean beneath it, right? And then what that hook enables someone to do and the kinds of, stories they tell about it. I don't know.
And I imagine the vapor baths, for example, reflect certain...
Yeah, they reflect understandings, exactly. They would reflect understandings of health and body that were popular as well as kind of elitely formed in literature as well. Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
You know, one of my favorite bits I've read about teaching from Laurel Thatcher Ulrich, and she gives an example of a 19th century cotton quilt and all of the things you can spin out from there to your students.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously the focus on domesticity for women, the growth of the cotton in the U.S. There's a semester.
Yeah.
And then manufacturing of textiles. And I just love thinking that. I love what objects can
And the history of thread and the thread cities that developed.
Yeah.
And I lived in Willimantic, Connecticut for a while, which was a thread city that then lost the thread industry afterwards. And as a town, it really suffered afterwards. So
yeah,
just thinking about the stories that people tell on those quilts and the colors they put together
that means. Mm-hmm. You could teach a lot about Utah history, maybe, from these objects.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe American history.
Yeah.
And in this case, we don't really have the objects themselves, but we've got the
sometimes the objects were sent with them. So if the object was portable, it would say that they had submitted the actual object with the design as well. Mm-hmm. And so I know that from New Mexico, for example, with the woman I'm working on who did a canteen, she actually submitted the canteen with her design.
She created one and sent it.
And so I know, you know, a number of those objects were preserved. There were some terrible fires, actually, that destroyed a lot of the submissions. But, so one of the things that I've been thinking about, actually, it would be really neat if, you know, we could create some of these. So I'm not going to create a vapor bath. But some of these would be neat to recreate and see what they did. And, you know, I've thought about a kind of display or something. It would be neat to make the canteen, for example, mm-hmm. or to make a step into a wagon that could fold out. I think I could, you know, maybe do that. I don't think I could make a life preserver for the head. But, yeah, it would be really, you know, and I always wonder if maybe somewhere in an attic somewhere someone has some of these mm-hmm. objects. Right? With that revolving table that I mentioned, we know that was manufactured for several years and that many people bought them. And there, I find, you know, advertisements in the paper for people selling them.
How big was it? It wasn't like a lazy chair.
No, it was very large. It was a supper table for, you know, you and your family to sit around, right?
Okay.
And so they actually had the, you know, that was part of the table. So I've often wondered, maybe someone has that in an attic somewhere. And wouldn't that be great if they could bring that out and we knew what that was? Mm-hmm. And at least take a photograph of it.
That's wonderful.
Well, interesting thing. Thank you for your insights, I think. Very interesting what you were saying about the sort of the background behind your research, mm-hmm. sources that you went to, as well as your various approaches to this topic. It's a nice article.
It's very nice,
Oh, thank you so much. And thank you for taking the time to talk to me further about this.
Yeah.
I really appreciate it.
Good.
Thank you.
Cool, thanks.